Hello, my name is Lance Lucero, and I'm the product manager of Astronomy at Celestron. And I have some exciting astronomical news for you. Comet 2023 A3 Tsuchinshan-ATLAS is finally here and putting on a great show. So I'm going to give you some pointers and tips on how to find and observe this comet. I do apologize for butchering the pronunciation of the name of this comet, so please, from here on out, I'm just going to call it 2023 A3. Comet 2023 A3 is expected to reach magnitude 2.1, or approximately as bright as Polaris, the North Star, around October 9th, when the comet moves from being a morning object seen before dawn to an evening object seen after sunset. Unfortunately, the day when it will be at its brightest, it will be lost in the glare of the sun and not visible to us. We need to wait for it to get high enough in the western sky after sunset to be seen again. But now that the comet is on its way out of the solar system, it's rapidly getting farther and farther and is going to dim more rapidly. By October 14th, it's expected to lose at least 3 or 4 magnitudes of brightness and will get continuously fainter each night as it climbs higher and higher out of the twilight and into the darkening sky. So your best chance to see it is to find a western horizon that is as flat as possible with no trees or buildings to get in the way, and try looking right after sunset, starting on October 11th. Each night, the comet will rise a little bit higher in the sky at sunset. With any luck, we'll get a chance to see it before it fades enough that optical aid will be needed to see it. On October 16th, Comet 2023 A3 will pass within 1 degree of the globular cluster M5. This is a perfect opportunity to get out your small telescope and point it at M5 and see this comet in the same field of view using a low-power eyepiece. It's not often that you get to see two objects like this in the same field, so if you do get an opportunity, please track that down on October 16th. So let's first talk about how to find the comet. There are a lot of good resources on the web where you can go and download finder charts for the comet, but they generally only show you where the comet is for a specific date, time, and latitude. So they can be very difficult to use if you live in a different location or are observing at a different time or day. Your best bet to find the comet on any date is Celestron's Sky Portal app, powered by Sky Safari. This app, available for iOS and Android, is included with every Celestron telescope purchase and features a full planetarium interface showing you how to locate objects for your specific date, time, and location. The app files are a little large, so I would recommend that you download this when you're at home and connected to Wi-Fi instead of using your data plan out in the field. Once you've installed the app, simply click the search button in the lower left corner. Tap Bright Comets. It will now display a list of the comets that are visible to you, brightest to faintest. You can see the listed magnitude of each comet shown in the description. Magnitude is simply a scale of brightness, but it can be a little counterintuitive in that the higher the number, the fainter the object is. Most adults under clear, dark skies with dark adapted eyes can see down to a magnitude 6.5. Under city skies, where light pollution makes the sky a little brighter, your eyes do not dilate fully, and as a result, you may be limited to only seeing stars down to magnitude 3 or 4. The object you're trying to find has to be brighter than your ambient sky glow, or it will not be visible. Some of these comets in the app's database are grayed out, but this is because they're not above your horizon and therefore not observable yet. As the Earth rotates and these objects rise above your horizon, they will light up and become selectable. So select our comet. It should be the comet that is listed first because it's the brightest one on the list. The screen will then show details about the comet. If you're seeing a description of the object, just hit the toggle button called Data down at the bottom right corner, and the data page will be displayed. The key information you want to scroll down to is the selection called Celestial Coordinates. Look for the azimuth and altitude coordinates. These are displayed in real time, and you may actually see the numbers change as you watch them. Azimuth is basically a compass heading, where 0 degrees is true north, not magnetic north, and it counts upward as you move clockwise. So if you're facing north and you turn 90 degrees to the right, you are now facing due east, or 90 degrees. 180 degrees is due south, and 270 degrees is due west. True north and magnetic north can be a little confusing. They can be up to 10 to 15 degrees off, depending where you are on Earth. So if you're using a handheld compass, it's probably best to look up your magnetic offset for your specific longitude and latitude, and then subtract or add that number to your magnetic compass heading as required. This will give you true north. Some smartphones have compass apps that already take this into account and will actually read out true north with the correction already added in. Simply turn yourself so that your body is now facing the azimuth coordinate indicated by the Sky Portal app. Altitude, the second number that you saw, is actually the number of degrees above the horizon that the object will appear. Now, those numbers really don't mean much to people, so I'm going to show you a simple trick on how to tell angular distances using only your hand. If you fully extend your arm in front of you and look at your fingers, your pinky represents, at arm's length, approximately 1 degree of sky. 3 fingers will represent approximately 5 degrees of sky. Your fist, with your thumb tucked down, this area right here, will be approximately 10 degrees of sky. If you spread your pinky and your index finger, you're now looking at approximately 15 degrees of sky. And if you stretch your thumb and pinky out as far as you can, you are generally looking at about 25 degrees of sky. Now, since everybody's built differently and you have different size hands and different length arms, this is kind of a good rule of thumb, or hands, as it were, that will get you close enough for this purpose and get you a good starting point for your comet search. So if the app shows that the comet is being approximately 23 degrees above the horizon, all you need to do is, again, hold your arm out with your pinky and thumb spread out. Remember, this is 25 degrees from tip to tip. Place your pinky at the visible horizon and start your search just below the tip of the thumb, being 23 degrees, or just slightly less than the 25. For those of us who are observing from a light-polluted suburb with lots of sky glow, it's a good idea to try using optical aid. This is where binoculars, a monocular, spotting scopes, a telescope all come into play. Any optical instrument is going to help you increase the amount of light entering your naked eye. For example, if you use a simple 25 millimeter objective binocular, you're increasing the amount of light that gets into your eyeball by almost a factor of 12. A 50 millimeter binocular will increase it to almost 74 times, and an 80 millimeter telescope would increase it to approximately 130 times the normal light gathering power of the naked eye. So any size optics is going to be a help, even in the heart of a light polluted city. Binoculars are the best optics to use because they offer a low power and a wide field of view. Comets can be large objects, sometimes with tails extending a few degrees. High magnification is not really required to see it, and a lot of times the wider field of view helps because you see more sky and it frames the target, making it more contrasty with the darkening sky behind it, making it just look spectacular. When searching for comets with optical aid, the best way to do it is to start by using the altitude and azimuth coordinates that we talked about that you got from the Sky Portal app. What you want to do is, once you have found the proper location where you need to start, that's when you get your binoculars or your spotting scope or whatever else that you're using, and you basically point it upward in that general direction. Then what you want to do is slowly start moving back and forth, left and right, at the same altitude, and look and see if you see it. If you don't see it, then move up slightly, no more than one field of view, because you don't want to leave any empty space in your search pattern. So you go up by about one field of view, and then you start tracking the opposite direction. And you repeat this snaking pattern back and forth until you see it. Just remember, sometimes you might have been a little high in your estimate of where to start. So if you don't see it the first time, go back to your initial starting point, and then allow yourself to move down and left and right instead of up and left and right, and chances are you're going to find it. The key here is slow movements. If the sky is still bright from the sunset, the comet is not going to be very bright and won't be very contrasty against that background. So it can be easy to miss. It'll be a very subtle signal coming through when the sky is that light. So if you go rapidly, there's a good chance that you're going to miss it. So just take your time, settle in, go slowly, and keep in mind that as twilight settles and the brightness starts to fall, the comet will stand out a little bit more and be easier to find. A strong word of caution about using optics to find the comet. Please wait until the sun is fully set below the horizon before starting your search. The last thing you want to do is accidentally flash the sun across the field of view while looking through an eyepiece. This can result in not only permanent damage to your equipment, it could be far worse, giving you permanent damage to your eyes. So please take the precaution and wait for the sun to go fully down behind the horizon before bringing out optics. Even when searching with the naked eye, you want to please wait until the sun is fully set, just again to avoid any long-term damage to your eyes. When using binoculars, people often ask, should you use them handheld or tripod mounted? And to be honest with you, either one is good, but it really kind of depends on the magnification of the binocular. Generally speaking, anything around 7 power or 8 power is very easy to hand hold. You can actually freestand and hold them without any difficulty at all. But when you start getting to 10 power binoculars or higher, you are going to magnify every little movement of your body, every little shake in your arm is going to become very obvious in the eyepiece and can make getting a stable image very, very tough. So what I would recommend in that case is using a tripod for anything 10 power or higher. But if you don't have a tripod or tripod adapter, one of the best things you can do is just find something solid and brace your elbows on top of them. For example, the roof of a car. If you're parked where you're observing, just simply brace your elbows on the roof of the car and then use your hands to adjust your altitude here and keeping your elbows braced. And that will definitely help minimize the shaking. One major advantage to using a tripod, however, is that if you observe with friends and family, or if you have kids and you realize that they might have a difficult time trying to find the comet, the great thing about a tripod is once you have your comet zeroed in and it's locked in on the tripod, you can step away from the eyepiece and allow other people to step up and look at it without having to acquire it for themselves. It just makes it a lot easier, especially if you have people that are not into astronomy and you're trying to show it to them. It's really hard to point and say, well, if you look here, it's just easier if you tripod mount it and let the tripod hold it for you. Telescopes are okay to use. Smaller scopes with low magnification and wide fields of view are highly recommended. Larger aperture telescopes will collect more light and give you more detail, but generally speaking, they have longer focal lengths, which means higher magnification and narrower fields of view. You're not going to be able to see the comet in all its glory with your average large telescope. Instead, you will get a very detailed view of the comet's coma, which is the little head with the fuzz. And you might even be able to see some detail within the comet's tail itself that would be invisible to smaller scopes. So the takeaway here is use whatever optics that you have. Anything that gets more light into your little 6 millimeters of aperture of your eyeball is only going to be a win. So again, whatever optics you have, whether it be that binocular that you use for bird watching or watching football games, or a spotting scope you use, out on your deck, those are optics and they're gonna work. So by all means, take the time to bring them out, set them up, and use them. If you don't have any optical equipment and are looking to purchase something, you may want to consider Celestron's Cometron binoculars, or any of the SkyMaster binoculars. For telescopes, you should consider Celestron's Travelscope 70, the PowerSeeker 114 EQ, or the PowerSeeker 127 EQ, the AstroMaster 130 EQ, or the StarSense Explorer DX-130. These products will offer the excellent low magnification and wide fields of view perfect for catching the comet. We'll have links to the products in the description below. Remember that these tips and tricks are not just for the comet 2023 A3. They can be used for any future bright comets that happen by. Please stay tuned to Celestron social media. If any new comets are found that might get bright enough to see, we'll let you know when and where to look. Thank you so much for your time. I wish you clear skies and good seeing.